Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is May 20th, 2018, the day of Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte, and the choir director is Vicki Perks. Today's reader of the lesson will be Steve Clark. Communion assistant will be Becky Dimitroff. The ushers are Linda and Nelson Smith.
It's not 856 and it's not 369. is 396, which is right on that board, but nowhere else. Hymn number 396, Spirit of Gentleness. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds and power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Until our hearts are
Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I'm going to him who sent me, yet no one rests me. Where are you going? But because I've said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and he will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are coming, that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, there will be no Wednesday service this Wednesday. Gene and I will be out of town Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And I forgot to mention it last Wednesday at the service, so no Wednesday night service this Wednesday. Also, a reminder that next Sunday, the 8 o'clock service will be out at the Melody Drive as we celebrate Memorial Day weekend. So there is no 8 o'clock service from now until Labor Day at the church. From next week, Labor Day, the 8 o'clock service is out at the Melody Drive. Also, today, we thank the choir for all their service. They will be taking a break for the summer. Individuals will be singing throughout the summer at the drive-in near church, but as a whole choir, they will not reassemble until September. So we thank the choir for all their work from last September till today for all the special music they give us. Also, my thanks to the member of the sewing group responsible for fixing my chasuble so I could wear it today. I have another one, but it has a cross on it. This is the Pentecost one, so my thanks to that individual who fixed the big rip I had in the sleeve. Also received this week in the mail, it says, with my thanks, dear St. John's, thank you so much for the lovely corsage and prayers you gave me last Sunday. I shall miss all of you. Blessings, Carol Blake. Thoughtfulness means a lot to me. Now I ask that you give your attention to the choir.
Thank you.
peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we grow in life and continue our journey of life, we come under influences of all kinds. In a normal situation, the first influence we have are usually our parents. Or, if we live by our grandparents, the influence can be our parents and grandparents both. Sometimes it can include aunts and uncles, or older cousins, or even older brother and sister. As we grow in our school, then we can be influenced by our teachers. Last night, to my amazement, I told Gina, I said, I can remember every one of my teachers from first through sixth grade. I sit there and rattle all their names off. I don't know where that came from, but I hadn't thought about my elementary school teachers in forever. Obviously, they had an influence on me because I remembered everyone. And as we grow, not only do our teachers influence us, but we're influenced by what we read, we're influenced by news, we're influenced by music, we can be influenced by movies, by art. We can be influenced if we go to college by professors. If we are called to go into a trade, we can be influenced by the instructor who teaches us how to tear down and rebuild an engine or an air conditioning system or a heating system or lay bricks or be a mason or whatever calling we have. And we can be influenced by society. And also, which seems to be a major influence today in the lives of many, influence of politics. However, as a child of our Heavenly Father, as brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ, there is one influence that we are to have above all others. And we are to live under that influence at all times. And that is the influence of the Holy Spirit. We are always to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Today is Pentecost, the birthday of the church. This is that day the disciples had been waiting for, that Jesus had told them about in the upper room, as we heard in the 15th and 16th chapters of the Gospel of John that we read. That all took place in the upper room. He told them that the Holy Spirit, the helper, the advocate, the comforter, would come, but he didn't tell them when. When he ascended into heaven, he again reminded them, in fact told them to go back to Jerusalem and wait for that Holy Spirit. And so, without warning, here comes the Holy Spirit on that first Pentecost. And because of being under the influence of the Holy Spirit, the apostles pour out into the streets and again to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ in languages they didn't even know. So that people from all over the Roman Empire were able to hear the good news of Jesus in their own language. And then Peter stands up and gives his great Pentecost sermon, and as St. Luke tells us, 3,000 people came under the call and influence of the Holy Spirit that day, and the church began. And so it is important for us to understand the work of the Holy Spirit. In the explanation to the third article of the Apostles' Creed in our small catechism, we are told that the Holy Spirit calls us to the gospel, enlightens us with its gifts, sanctifies, and keeps us in the true faith. At our baptism, the Holy Spirit enters into our heart and mind to call us to a life of faith. As we continue to grow, as we attend Sunday school and Bible school and church, as we go to Bible studies, as we read God's Word on our own, the Holy Spirit continues to call us to this faith that becomes greater and greater. Or should, if we are, and will, if we are under the influence of the Holy Spirit. It enlightens us with its gifts. The word enlightens means the Holy Spirit working through God's Word to provide knowledge of God's love for us in Jesus Christ, so the
That is what it means when we say the Holy Spirit enlightens us with his gifts. It works through God's word to provide us with knowledge of God's love in Jesus Christ, giving us that wisdom to do that which is well pleasing to God. That is being under the influence. Under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Of course, in life, there are some things we don't want to be under the influence of. And of course, the two most obvious, we do not want to be under the influence of alcohol or under the influence of drugs. Because both of those can lead to very damaging situations. But we want to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit. We want him enlightening us with his gifts and sanctifying and keeping us in the true faith. The word sanctify, that means to make holy. But it doesn't mean to make holy in a sense of making you a super pious person who never sins and always does what God wants. Because that is impossible in this earthly life. The word holy here means to be separated for use by God. It means consecrated to the service of God. It means to be chosen by God. So we are all holy. This is why you see the apostles in their letters to the churches and letters to individuals talking about being holy. Because we have been set apart. We have been called. We have been chosen to be servants of our Lord Jesus Christ and of God through our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we celebrate this outpouring of the Spirit, because without the Holy Spirit we wouldn't come to faith. Without the Holy Spirit we would have no gifts to use in service to our Lord. Without the Holy Spirit we would never be holy and stay committed to the true faith. The Holy Spirit then not only calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies, it also enables us, first of all, to be filled with him. To be under the influence of the Spirit, we have to be filled with the Spirit. As we read in the second verse of the second chapter of Acts, our first reading, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Suddenly. It was unexpected. They didn't know at what time. It's just like Jesus' return. Jesus keeps telling us, or told us in the Gospels, that we would not know when he would return. He'd be like a thief in the night. Well, that's the way the Holy Spirit came. That word suddenly means to be unexpected, an unexpected occurrence. And so the disciples were shocked that the Holy Spirit came upon them, as the people in the streets were shocked with what they saw the apostles doing. The word filled means to cram, like cramming everything you can in a duffel bag until you can hardly close it, or to take one of these big plastic tubs and you put your winter clothes and you cram it as full as you can. You got to sit on the lid in order to get it closed because you've crammed so much stuff in. So to be filled with the Holy Spirit means it's crammed in us. Crammed overflowing. So that we can be that follower of Jesus Christ. The word also means to supply us with what we need. This is an important point in the life of the church today. The church needs witnesses. The church needs people to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But people are afraid to do it because they don't feel like they have what they need. Well, we'll never have what we need if we try to do it by our own reason and understanding. It is the Holy Spirit that supplies us with that ability to witness. It is the Holy Spirit that supplies us with that strength and that courage to share with someone who is a non-believer or a backslider or another religion, to share Don't panic, because the Holy Spirit will give you what to say. That is what it is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And when filled with the Holy Spirit, we come under its influence. As we read in verse 17, "And in the last days it shall be," God declares, "that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh." Pour out means to bestow something on someone. But not just bestow, like a king or queen bestowing knighthood on a knight by placing the sword over his shoulders and saying, "I now demand you," or whatever. Oh, this means to bestow in the sense of gushing over, gushing out. It means to spill out. So when we're under the influence of the Holy Spirit should be gushing out of us, should be spilling out of us. It doesn't mean that you're going to suddenly start shaking and doing the Holy Spirit dance, as they used to call it. That doesn't mean that suddenly you're going to be babbling in tongues that nobody can understand. It simply means you're going to have an excitement for your faith in Jesus Christ. You're going to have that excitement for Jesus that you do for your favorite sports team, or you have for your favorite composer, or you have for your favorite artist in the world of music, whatever kind of music you listen to. But people get all excited about those kind of things. But when it comes to Jesus, we quote an old movie from back in the late 80s, early 90s. Too often we Christians act like the frozen children. We don't overflow, we don't gush, we don't spill out for that love of Jesus, or to share that love of Jesus with others. We allow society to intimidate us far too often. Society tells us, "Go to church on Sunday, practice your faith on Sunday, and the rest of the week keep quiet about it." That's not what Jesus told us to do. That's not how the church acted. That's not how the church acted for years and for centuries. Instead, the people were under that influence of the Holy Spirit, so much so that they couldn't contain themselves in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, even in the face of persecution, even in the face of opposition. So we are to live under the Holy Spirit's influence, to allow it to take complete control of us, enable it to give us what we need in service to the Lord. As I told my Sunday school class and mentioned in the 8 o'clock service, there was a pastor who gave his confirmation class a motto for the Christian life. And the motto was STS, saved to serve. And when you read the final part of Luther's explanation to the second article of the creed, that is what he's emphasizing. That we are saved by the Redeemer. So as the redeemed, we serve Him and serve God the Father. Not in order to earn salvation, not in order to earn grand importance, but as a response to that love that God has first shown us through the giving of His Son, Jesus Christ, who so willingly went to the cross on our behalf so that we might have forgiveness and the gift of salvation. So we want to live under the influence of the Holy Spirit and allow it to spill out and gush out of us. And the third thing that we need is to be driven by the Holy Spirit. As we continue with verse 17, "And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." What's the common word in all three of this? Shall. Meaning to be driven to do so. The Holy Spirit drives our experiences of faith. The Holy Spirit drives us to witness. The Holy Spirit enables us to act contrary to society. The Holy Spirit reminds us that see a lot of rocks and marble and pillars and crumbling buildings that once were magnificent. You go to the Colosseum, before the original Colosseum is caved in, so when you go look at it, you see the cages in the dungeons that the people in the stands didn't see because they were under the floor. But it's lost as well. You go to Greece and see the crumbling acropolis. But Jesus Christ is forever. Where the world is driven by lust and greed and power and fame and fortune and wealth, all which are temporary, we are driven by the Holy Spirit. Driven by the Holy Spirit to do that which brings about everlasting life. The Holy Spirit inspires us to do work that we could never do on our own. And again, as I have said the past several weeks, the church, instead of trying to figure out its problems in a with earthly or solution or reason, solution by reason, we need to rely on the Holy Spirit. We need to call upon the Holy Spirit for revival. We need to call upon the Holy Spirit to charge us up so that we are driven by the Holy Spirit to share with others that good news. The church would never spread like it did if people had ignored the power of the Holy Spirit. If people had ignored God calling them to witness to others, to share with others. And when I say witness, I'm not talking about standing on a soapbox on a corner downtown and shouting at people as they go by. I'm not talking about people we see every now and then up at the corner of Pleasant Yellow Spring Street who stand and yell at the traffic as it goes by. I'm talking about one-on-one. I'm talking with someone who is not a believer. Or someone who was with you in confirmation class and you've never seen him since. I'm talking about someone who is of a different religion. Not harassing people. Not haranguing people on the street corner. But witnessing where no one. So often, it was simply an invitation to come and see. What was Philip, who went to his buddy Nathaniel and said, "We found the Messiah, come and see," made that invitation. Andrew, James, and John said to Peter, "Come and see." It's the Holy Spirit that drives us, not our reason. And so do not be afraid of being under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Do not be afraid to allow the Holy Spirit to guide your daily life. Because that's what it has been sent to do. It's been sent to help us be that chosen, that separated, that consecrated people of God in faith in Jesus Christ. It is the Holy Spirit that directs us into our call, to our profession, to our trade, to whatever it is that the Lord has in store for us. So while there are good influences in life and bad influences, never be afraid of the influence of the Holy Spirit. Never be afraid to submit to the influence of the Holy Spirit. And allow the Holy Spirit to influence everything you do to the glory of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. This morning you may at this point remain seated as we are going to sing the Haven of Rest, which is printed on the back cover of your book. Haven of Rest. Back.
Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Standing in the glorious light of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who wait for the Spirit's revealing power. Our response today is, Come, Holy Spirit. Come to your church and inflame the hearts of your people to convey your love faithfully and boldly to the world. We pray.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come from the four winds, O breath of God, and breathe your peace into the hearts of every nation, that violence and war may cease in all the world. We pray.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come and let your healing breath surround the sick, that they may be given new life and new health. We pray.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come and let the new wine of your presence give us vision as we gather at your table of mercy. They are to be strengthened and sent into the world empowered with your good news. We pray.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come and intercede for those who groan in grief, that together with all your blessed saints, they might be united by your Spirit with those for whom they mourn. We pray.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Gracious God, hear our prayers and receive them for the sake of the crucified and risen one, our Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Christ our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, we believe his body and blood are truly present as a gathering of state, and our communion age and own individual congregation, we invite and encourage to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 7 in your school. The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
body of Christ given to me. Those who can, please stand. By the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Here I Am, Lord, hymn number 574 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 574.
Who will bear my life to them? Amen.